Good morning to Vandal. Today we are going to discuss briefly about feature transformation. Feature engineering is having two major elements. Number one, feature transformation. Number two, feature subset selection. And there are two variants of feature transformation. Number one, feature construction. Number two, feature extraction. If you look into feature construction, it is meant for creating additional features which are more powerful with the help of existing features. For example, consider a linear regression problem for estimating the apartment price using the following features. X1 represents apartment length, X2 represents apartment width, Y represents apartment price. We need to predict the apartment price Y with the help of these two features X1 and X2. That is our target. Here apartment means one flat in apartment. Either you can think. Then linear regression model for price prediction is Y hat equals to W1 X1 plus W2 X2. In this particular linear regression model, our target is we need to estimate the parameters W1 and W2 with the help of training data that we are having. We will have some training samples with these features and the concerned price Y, X1, X2, Y, once again X1, X2, Y, once again X1, X2, Y for different cases. We will try to have n such training samples. With the help of those n training samples, by using this model, and you can try to apply mean square error loss function, and after that you can go for gradient descent algorithm to estimate the parameters W1 and W2. In that way, we will try to find this model with the help of training data and this model with gradient descent algorithm. This may not predict well. In general, if you want to predict the price of a flat, then it's better to consider the flat area or apartment area instead of that length and width. It's a general scenario. So what we are going to do is we'll try to construct a third feature with the help of these two existing features. Let's call that third feature as X3. X3 equals to X1 into X2. This is representing apartment area. Then we will try to predict the price of that flat or that apartment with the help of these three features together. Y hat equals to W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W3 X3. We have this third feature with an additional one. Now if you try to do once again same thing with the help of our training samples, find mean square error loss and try to apply gradient descent algorithm to minimize that mean square error. Finally, you are going to have some solution W1, W2, W3 with you. This will be far better compared to this one, this first model. Here, feature construction helps us. Let us have a look into these linearly separable classes. Let's assume that this is class 1. These samples correspond to class 2. We are having two classes, omega 1 and omega 2. We have two classes. These two class samples can be separable with the help of a line, right? When you go to higher dimension, this is just a two-dimensional space. If you go for n-dimensional space or d-dimensional space where d greater than 2, then we can call this line as a hyperplane. Hyperplane is the separating boundary here between class 1 and class 2. In this case, this is just a line. W transpose x plus W naught equal to 0. W transpose x plus W naught equal to 0. Here W transpose means W1, W2 vector, and X means X1, X2 vector, 2 cross 1 vector. It means that the expression for this is W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W0 equal to 0. This is the decision boundary. Suppose if you are above this decision boundary, then you can call it like class 1. For example, W transpose X plus W0 greater than 0, you can call it like class 1. If W transpose X plus W0 less than 0, you can call it like class 2. Here we are trying to use perceptron learning algorithm to learn these weights or the parameters. Here the weights corresponds to W1, W2, and one more parameter is there, right? Bias. This is a bias, W0. We need to learn these three parameters with the help of our training data. Our training data will be of this form. We'll have X1, X2. Let's have that notation for training data. This is a classification task, right? This is training data sample 1, training example 1, X1, X2, comma the concerned class label Y1. This is first training sample, and ith training sample is represented as follows, or kth training sample is represented as follows: x1k, x2k, and yk. This is the kth training sample, and we'll have n such training samples with us, k equals to 1, 2, and so on up to n such training samples we are having. With the help of these n training samples, we need to estimate those parameters with the help of an algorithm called as perceptron learning algorithm, which will make use of gradient descent algorithm once again. Using perceptron learning algorithm, we will try to estimate these parameter values W1, W2, and W0. This expression corresponds to W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W0 equal to 0. And with the help of perceptron learning algorithm, the possible boundaries we are going to get is as follows. For example, this corresponds to class 1 samples, and this corresponds to class 2 samples. See class 1 omega 1, this corresponds to class 2 samples, and the possible decision boundaries for them are, this is one possible decision boundary, linear decision boundaries, and this is one possible linear decision boundary, this is another possible linear decision boundary, another one is another linear possible decision boundary, another decision boundary, like this. We are having infinitely many such linear decision boundaries. Based on our random initial guess about the weights W1, W2, and bias W0, we'll try to start with some random initial guess over these weights and biases, and after that we'll try to train this with the help of perceptron learning algorithm based on this random initial guessing of the weights. Based on this random initialization, we might end up with either this decision boundary or this decision boundary or this one or this one or this one and so on. There are infinitely many such possible decision boundaries, linear decision boundaries, in this particular example. We'll try to get one out of them, one out of infinitely many such possibilities. One decision boundary out of infinitely many such decision boundaries we are going to get after training with the help of perceptron learning algorithm. But which one do you feel like a very good Asian boundary? In the sense, let's consider an example for this. Let's assume this is one decision boundary, one possible decision boundary. And another decision boundary I am going to consider is this one. See, another decision boundary. Let's assume there are two possible decision boundaries. This green one looks very good as compared to red one. The reason for this one is, suppose my test sample is somewhere here. For example, my test sample is somewhere here. This is my test sample after training. Let's consider this like class 1, this is class 2. And with our intuition, we can say that this might be belongs to class 1 as compared to class 2 with our intuition, because this is far away from class 2 and very nearer to class 1 samples, right? Even if you apply the k-nearest neighbor algorithm. But if you go for this kind of decision boundary, this is falling in class 2, right? This is falling in class 2. It's not falling in class 1. It look bit odd for you, right? If you apply intuition. Instead of that, if you go with this boundary, this decision boundary, this sample is below this, right? Then you can try to classify this as class 1. If your test sample is somewhere here, for example, if your test sample is somewhere here, then that can be classified as class 2, even with this boundary also. This is looking good for you, right? There is some margin for you. There is some margin provided for your samples, right? That means your class 1 samples can go up to the, can fall in this margin also. And your class 2 sample also can fall within this margin. It won't get any problem to you, right? That kind of margin can be learned with the help of SVM, support vector machine. This is a support vector machines. We'll try to maximize this margin. You can try to see this. This decision boundary looks very good as compared to these decision boundaries. The other decision boundaries, they learned with the help of a perceptron. For some initial guess of parameters, this boundary you are getting. For some other initial guess, you might get this boundary like this. As compared to all the decision boundaries, this looks far better, right? Because you are trying to provide some extra margin for your class 1 and extra margin for your class 2. In this case, this margin is same as this margin width. These two margin widths are same. We are trying to maximize this margin. This is also called as maximum margin classifier. The classifier that we learned with the help of support vectors. These are the support vectors. This one and these two are the support vectors here. This is also a linear decision boundary. This one also is of the form W1 x1 plus W2 x2 plus W0 equal to 0. This also. For example, if your data is not linearly separable, let's have a look into this one. This is class 1, blue color is class 1, this color corresponds to class 2. We can't separate them with the help of a linear decision boundaries, right? We can't separate them with the help of a single linear decision boundary. Then what we can do is, we can try to go for feature transformation. Instead of having features as x1 and x2, we'll try to go for square operation in this particular example. x1 square and x2 square. If you try to do x1 square and x2 square, the concerned samples we are going to get are these samples gets converted into these samples. This coordinate corresponds to x1 square, y coordinate corresponds to x2 square. Now we can see these two are linearly separable, right? They can be separated with the help of a line as follows. That is linearly separable after feature transformation. After suitable feature transformation, they can be linearly separable. Now this can be trained with the help of perceptron or SVM, right? That linear decision boundary can be trained with the help of perceptron or that SVM. This can be learned, that decision boundary. Here the decision boundary is as follows: w1 x1 square plus w2 x2 square plus w0 equal to 0. This is the decision boundary. And let's have a look into this one. This is also non-linearly separable data. We can't separate these two classes with the help of a single linear decision boundary. This corresponds to class 1, red color corresponds to class 2. You can't separate them with the help of a single line, right? Suppose if I go for this kind of feature transformation, what I am doing here is, I am trying to subtract the mean, and after that I am trying to multiply those two values. Let's try to find the mean value for feature x1 for all these samples together, average of all these samples, and similarly the mean value for this feature 2 across all samples. We'll try to find x1 bar, we'll try to find x2 bar. After that, we will try to subtract x1 bar from x1 component, and we will try to subtract x2 bar from this x2 component. Once you have done that one, we will try to multiply both the components. This is x1 minus mean value x1 bar into x2 minus x2 bar. Once you do this feature transformation, then we are going to end up with these samples, red and blue. Now this is clearly separable, right? With the help of a line. This can be separable with the help of a line. Here you don't require even line also. You don't require even line also, right? Because this is just one dimensional data. It's not a two dimensional data. It's a one dimensional data. You are having only one feature with you, right? You can simply go for this threshold. Let me call this as x3. This feature I am calling it like x3. x3 equals to x1 minus 2.7 into x2 minus 2.2. Let me call this like x3. If x3 greater than 0, then we can call it like class 1, blue color, right? If x3 less than 0, we can call it like class 2. This red color, right? It means feature transformation will help us in order to separate them with the help of linear boundaries, right? Linear decision boundaries. That will simplify a lot, feature transformation. But that should be suitable feature transformation for our classification task. Thank you.